Praise the Lord. Praise the servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore, from the rising of the sun to the place where it sets. The name of the Lord is to be praised. Let's bow down in prayer. Almighty and gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we come in thy presence, O Lord, this blessed Sunday morning, thanking and praising the Lord for this time. And Father, Lord, we pray that your name be glorified in and through the service of Master. Father, Lord, we pray that you will be exalted, O Master, Lord. Towards this end, we commit ourselves, O Master, in thy almighty arms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, let's turn in our hymnals at this time to hymn number 30, hymn number 30. Rise to our feet and join in this hymn. Hymn number 30, When Morning Gilds the Skies, My Heart Awakening Cries. I'll read one part of the verse, you can respond with the next. Keep me safe, O God.
For in you I take refuge.
I say to the Lord, you are my Lord.
Apart from you I have no good thing.
As for the saints who are in the land,
they are the glorious ones in whom is all my delight.
The sorrows of those will increase who run after other gods. I will not pour out their libations of blood, or take up their names on my lips. Lord, you have assigned me my portion and my cup. You have made my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places.
Surely
I have a delightful inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night my heart instructs me. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure. Because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the path of life. You will find me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. Psalm 16 says, keep me safe, O God, for in you I take refuge. Taking refuge in the Lord means trusting the Lord completely. And when you trust in the Lord, as this particular Psalm of David says, that I will not pour out their libations of blood or take their names on my lips. Not run after other gods, not run after other people for help, but rather just trust in the Lord at all times. And when we trust in the Lord, right from verse 5 onwards, the psalmist tells us all that God does for us. It says, He has assigned to me my portion and my cup. You have made my Lord secure. You see verse 7, it says, I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night my heart instructs me. You know, so God is always there for us, but we need to trust Him for who He is, and what He has done in our life, and what He keeps doing in our life. Right, this is the time that we spend in praise and worship of the Lord.
Worship the Lord by singing a few choruses from the chorus sheet that we have. The first song that we'll sing is, all heavens declare the glory of the risen Lord. Who can compare to the beauty of the risen Lord?
All heavens declare, all heavens declare the glory of the risen Lord.
Says, Majesty, worship His Majesty. unto Jesus be all glory, power and praise.
Majesty, worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, power and praise.
Praise and let us exalt the name of our Lord our God.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. With a heart full of praise, with a heart full of praise.
Promise of the week is taken from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 3. Well, 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 3, what did it say? For the Lord is faithful. And he will strengthen and protect you from the evil one. He will strengthen and protect you from the evil one. The Lord is faithful. Right? That's a promise that God has given us this morning. And let's keep this promise with us. That the Lord is faithful. He will not leave his people. And he will not only really strengthen us in our need, but also protect us from the evil one. All right. Let's. Is there anyone who wants to give us a testimony at this time? We can listen to that and praise the name of the Lord. The Lord has spoken to you. The Lord has done some work in your life. We can hear that before we go in a time of praise and worship. Praise or praise and worship and thanksgiving unto the Lord. All right, let's bow down and pray. Father in heaven, we come in thy presence, O Master, this blessed morning, thanking and praising the Lord for this morning.
Amen.
Thanking the Lord for your word, Master, the promise of the week that you've given us, that you are faithful. Yes, Lord, you are faithful. Your faithfulness reaches the skies. Yes, Lord, there is no shadow of turning with thee. And Father, Lord, that is the reason we believe that you will not only strengthen us in our needs, but also protect us from the evil one. The evil one, Lord, is like a prowling lion, ready to devour anyone, O Master, who comes in his way. And yet, Master, we know that the one who is inside us, the one who is within us, is greater than the one who is outside. Lord, you have won over the world, you have won over Satan, Master, and Satan has no power over us. As Colossians 2:15 says, O Master, Lord, that you made a public spectacle of him on the cross, triumphing over him there on the cross, Master. And that is the reason we need not be afraid of the evil one. We need not live in fear of the evil one. The world lives in all kinds of fears, but we, O Lord, have been made free, O Lord, from all fear. All because, Master, we know that you are the one who protects us from the evil one. You are the one, in spite of he being a defeated enemy, we know that he is still powerful. But we know, Master, Lord, that you are the one who protects us. And when you are with us, Master, who can be against us? When you are our protector, God, who can do anything to us? when we are in your hands, O Master, who can snatch us from you? That's what the Lord Jesus Christ said, that no one can snatch you from my hand. Thank you, Lord, for these assurances that we have in your word. Thank you, Lord, that we can keep hold of these promises, because your promises are true, O Lord, at every moment of our lives. Especially, O Lord, when things are going bad for us, it is at those times that your promises are true. As David says, the Lord, in Psalms 23, if I walk the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. Yes, Lord. Because as we read, O Lord, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 3, you protect us from the evil one. Father, Lord, we thank you and praise you, Lord, for all these promises, all these assurances that you have given us. And help us to go forward, O Lord, in life, in spite of the raging winds, O Master. Help us to focus, O Lord, upon you, because you are the one who can silence, O Lord, the raging winds, O Lord. You are the one, O Lord, who can make us walk on the water, Master, even with all the waves that are raging aside us. They shall not overcome us. That's what your word tells us in Isaiah, Master, that even if I walk through the waters, they shall not overcome us. When I walk through the fire, that shall not burn us, because you are there with us. And you are there, Lord, with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, Master, right there in the furnace. Even as people from outside, look, they saw a fourth figure there. And Lord, we know that it was you who were there, and not one hair of these three believers, the Master, was singed. Even in that furnace, Lord, which people even could not go near to. And even the soldiers who went near to that were burnt, O Master. Father, Lord, we have confidence on you and you alone. Thank you, Lord. Forgive us for our sins, Lord, we pray. Everything that we have done against you in thought, word, and deed. Help us to walk the narrow path that you have called us to, because we know that eternity has been won for us. Lord, we may be here for maybe 60 years, 80 years, a little more, by our strength, but we know, Lord, that ultimately it's eternal life or eternal death. Eternity in your presence or eternity in the presence of evil ones and of the evil one. Lord, we pray that you will help us, Master, Lord, to know that the victory has been won and to live that victory here in this life, irrespective of the circumstances of life, Master. Father, Lord, we pray that we'll continue to bless each one who is here this morning. Pray that your name be glorified in and through our lives. The difficulties we may be facing, O Master, the problems we may be facing, we commit each one into the hands. Thou knowest, Lord. And Lord, we pray that you will find a solution for each of these things, O Lord, in our lives. But in the meantime, help us, O Lord, to just keep our faith intact, Master. Heavenly Father, we pray, Master Lord, for all that you want this church to do. Lead us, Lord, we pray. Father, Lord, we pray, Master Lord, for the Bible school. We do not know what you want us to do there. But Lord, if it's thy will that we continue that, we pray, O Lord, for the students. We pray, Master Lord, for the infrastructure. We pray, Master Lord, for the finances. Lord, even as you have given us, Lord, finances for the last four batches that we could conduct, Lord, even now we pray that you will give us a place, you will give us, Lord, that you will give us, O Master, the finances for the same, and lead us, Lord, to train more people, O God, who can go and share your word in different situations of the life, O Master. Father in heaven, we ask for your leading, O Lord, in this matter, Father. Pray, Master Lord, for the church as a whole, that you will bless it, O Master. Irrespective of the denominations, ask your blessings upon it, and let the every church, God, in spite of the small differences we may have in doctrine, hold on to, Lord, the core doctrine of the Trinity, the core doctrine of the atonement of our Lord Jesus Christ that he has achieved on the cross, the core doctrine, O Master, of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Yes, Master Lord, we pray that these are the core doctrines, O Lord, which unite the church together. For we believe in the one God, and we believe in the one baptism, and we believe, O Lord, in our one faith, O God. Father in heaven, we come to the church as a whole and all those who are working in the church in the hands, especially, O Lord, those who are facing persecution at this time. Pray, O Lord, that you will reach out to them and you will take care of the needs. Those, O Lord, who have been caught up in various scandals, O Lord, in the church. Lord, we pray that you will reach out to those people also and give them a heart of repentance, O God. Yes, Father, Lord, there are so many things that are coming out in these days against the church, be it the Catholic Church, be it the Protestant Church. So many things are coming out, O Master. I just want to pray this time that you, O Lord, will uphold these people in the hands, because we know that you have not left them, and help them, O Lord, to repent and come back, O Lord, to the throne of grace, O Master. Pray, Master Lord, for those areas where your word is not gone, that your word will go there, and many more souls may be saved, O Master. Pray, Master Lord, for the world as a whole, even as it goes through various problems. We pray that you will bring order in the chaos that is there. Continue praying, O Lord, for the warred areas of Palestine, of Ukraine, and many other smaller countries, O Lord, in the African subcontinent. Pray, Master Lord, for all those places where there is unrest. There are economic problems, O Lord, in an economic meltdown. All these places, O Master, we just want to pray for them, that you will reach out to them, Master. Father, Lord, we pray that your word may go powerfully and many, many people may be saved. And Father, Lord, the destruction that we see all around us, we pray, O Lord, that people of God may be able to keep their senses, O Master, their sense of humanity, O Lord, in these circumstances. And that can only come, O Lord, when we have faith in you. For this end, O Master, we commit all of us into thy almighty arms. We ask this in the most blessed name of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. A very warm welcome, my dear friends, to this worship service, and I welcome all of you in the most precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And next Sunday service will be at the same time, that is at 10 o'clock in the morning, and each one of us is invited for the same. Alright, we are going to sing one hymn at this time, hymn number 157. Hymn number 157. Safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on his gentle breast. There by his love overshaded, sweetly my soul shall rest. We'll rise to our feet and join in this hymn, and we'll bring our offerings unto the Lord at this time.
Safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on his gentle breast. By his love shaded, sweetly my soul shall rest. Hearkens the voice of angels, born in a song to me. Over the fields of glory, over the jasper sea, safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on his gentle breast. There by his love shaded, sweetly my soul shall rest. Safe in the arms hands of Jesus, save from corroding care, save from the world's temptation, sin cannot harm me there. Free from the blight of sorrow, free from my doubts and fears, only a few more trials, only a few more tears, safe in the arms of
Jesus,
safe on his gentle breast, there by his love o'shaded, sweetly my soul shall rest. Jesus, my heart's dear refuge, Jesus has died for me. Firm on the rock of ages, ever my trust shall be. Here let me wait with patience, wait till the night is o'er, wait till I see the morning break on the golden shore. Safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on a gentle breast, there by his love o'shaded, sweetly my soul shall rest. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him all creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Father Lord, we thank you for every good blessing you've given us in our life and the little that we have brought to you this morning. Pray, Lord, that you may bless it and use it, O Lord, for the extension of your kingdom, Master. And as we turn to your word, O God, your word may come alive to us. We may grow in your word, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. The word for today has been taken from Psalms 3. We open to Psalms 3. Psalms 3, and it reads, it's a psalm of David when he fled from his son Absalom. It says, O Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying to me, of me, God will not deliver him. But you are a shield around me, O Lord. You bestow glory on me and lift up my head. To the Lord I cry, and he answers me from my holy hill. I lie down and sleep. I awake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear the tens of thousands drawn up against me on every side. Arise, O Lord, deliver me, O my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessings be on your people. May the Lord have his blessings, reading and hearing of his holy word. This, my dear friends, is a beautiful psalm. Because it's a realistic psalm. It's a psalm which talks about the reality of who, not only who God is, but how he acts. And it's against much of the popular teaching that goes on in the churches today. Because most of the churches, they tend to teach something like claim it and gain it. You know, claim something in prayer and that will be yours. All right? Now this psalm goes against that particular grain, and we'll come to that point once again. But if you see, this particular psalm is divided into four parts, 8 verses and 2 verses each. The first 2 verses, verse 1 and 2, it's about David's complaint about his circumstances. Verses 3 and 4 is David's confidence in the Lord. Verses 5 and 6 is about David's confidence translated into peace. And verses 7 and 8, it's about David's prayer for deliverance. Right, so if you see the first 2 verses, it says, I'll read it once again. It says, O Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. This, I would say, is a continuation of Psalms 2. Because if you see Psalms 2, what was it all about? We saw it last time. It says there, the kings of the earth take their stand against the rulers, and the rulers gather together against the Lord and against the Anointed One. Verse 2. Okay, verse 1 says, why do the nations conspire and the people plot in vain? Instead of the nations there, it's Absalom here. Absalom against the Lord's anointed, and that's David. Okay, so the theme of Psalms 2 continues here in this particular psalm also. And we know the story. That's given in 2 Samuel chapter 15 onwards. Chapter 15 verse 13 onwards of Absalom. Absalom was a son of David, the son of David. Right, and it's a long history. But then when he came back to Jerusalem, he had done something, he had run away from Jerusalem, came back. But David was not ready to see him at that particular time. And what did Absalom do? You know, he stayed there in Jerusalem and he plotted against his father. He would go and stand in the Jerusalem gate, you know, and try to incite people. Slowly, he got the people on his side. And at one point of time, he went against his father. There was a coup against his father. That's against David. Right? So it's the son against the father. And at that time, we see David running away from there. He takes some of his faithful and he runs away from there. Because he knows who Absalom is. He knows that there's not going to be peace with him. There's not going to be reconciliation with him. In fact, if he does confront him at that particular point of time, he will execute him. He will get hold of him. He will execute him. And most of the army probably had gone on the side of Absalom at that time. So, David is very realistic, in spite of he knowing that God is on his side. You know, he does not confront Absalom at that time, but he runs away. And the kind of trouble that he's undergoing, we come to know from these 2 verses. Because the one word that is used time and again is many. How many? Verse 1. Verse 2. How many? Verse 3. Many. You know, that itself, this word many itself shows the kind of problem that David was undergoing. And trouble, my dear friends, when it comes in a great barrage. It comes in hordes. You know, you don't have trouble a little bit here and a little bit there. But when it comes, my dear friends, it comes in flocks and in numerous ways. One more thing that we need to see here is, who was David? You know, David was the second king of Israel. And he was the one who had consolidated the kingdom of Israel. You know, the first king was Saul. At that time, he was just going and fighting against the Philistines and the others. But here was one who had consolidated the kingdom. He had first made Hebron the capital, and then he had moved to Jerusalem, and he is now in Jerusalem, fortified city. You know, and the people were living in peace, and there was prosperity at that time. So David was one who had brought prosperity to the people. He had brought unity among the people. Right? Now these are the very people, my dear friends, who had gone on the side of Absalom. The people whom David had helped, the people whom David had helped to prosper, and there was peace in that land, these very people had gone against David. What does this show about man's nature? Man, my dear friends, you know, I just want you to open to one more chapter to kind of authenticate this particular theme that I'm getting at. 1 Samuel chapter 23 and verse 5. 1 Samuel chapter 23 and verse 5. Here is David who has gone to this place called Keilah or Keilah, and there the Philistines are looting this place, right? 1 Samuel chapter 23. They're looting this place, and David goes and he defeats the Philistines, right? And he saves Keilah. What does verse 5 say?
So David and his men went to Keilah, fought the Philistines and carried off their livestock. He inflicted heavy losses on the Philistines and saved the people of Keilah.
He saved the people of Keilah. All right? And then he hears at that time that Saul, he has come to know that David is there in this place. And so he hears that Saul is coming to fight against him and to kill him. So he inquires of the Lord, Lord, what should I do? Should I go away from here? Or should I just stay here? Will the people of this city whom I have saved, will they be against me or will they be for me? And what does the Lord tell him? Read verse 12.
Again David asked, will the citizens of Keilah surrender me and my men to Saul? And the Lord said, they will.
They will. Strange, isn't it? Just a few moments ago, he is the one who had come and saved them, you know. And here, the Lord is saying that if Saul comes, they will not be for you. They will surrender you. This is man's nature, my dear friends. Very difficult to trust people. You know, when they will turn against you, we really don't know. You see, that's man's nature. All right? Jesus Christ, he did so much for the people in his 3.5 years ministry, constantly healing people, you know, taking out demons and so on and so forth. And these very people, my dear friends, you know, on the day of Palm Sunday, they were shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, you know, we welcome this king in the name of God our Father. You know, they were shouting praises for Jesus Christ. 2 days later, you know, what were they saying? Crucify him, crucify him. These very people. See, so that's man's nature. That's man's nature. That he probably sees his own benefit. And that is where very difficult, my dear friends, to trust people. You see? So that's what comes out very clearly here. That these very people whom David had helped in to bring together, make a nation, are now against him. You know, and what are they saying about him? God will not deliver him. God will not deliver him. I think that's probably the worst thing that a person can say about anyone and the worst thing that a person can experience. In fact, Charles Spurgeon, he says something of this sort for this particular verse. He says, if all trials that come from heaven, all temptations that ascend from hell, and all the crosses that arise from the earth could be mixed and pressed together, right? That means if a person could go through the worst kind of troubles in his life, it says they would not make up a trail so terrible or trials so terrible as that which is contained in this verse. It is the most bitter of afflictions to be led to fear that there is no help for us from God. When a person, my dear friends, in whatever circumstance he is, if he feels that God is not there with me, that Spurgeon says, is the worst kind of trial that one can undergo. And he gives this example. He says, the trials that come from heaven or whatever trials we may undergo, if this thing is, if you feel that God is not with us, that is the worst kind of thing. And that's what people are saying here. You know, he says, God will not deliver him. God will not deliver them. And yet in this situation, my dear friends, the psalmist How does David start this psalm? In your Bibles?
Oh Lord.
All right? The circumstances are terrible before him. You know, overwhelming circumstances. He's not looking at the circumstances. He's looking at the Lord. He says, Oh Lord. His circumstances are there, but he's looking at the Lord, my dear friends. And that is the most important thing as far as this psalm is concerned. The psalmist David, in spite of all the troubles that he's undergoing, his focus is not on the circumstances that he's undergoing, but rather on the Lord. You know, and that comes out very clearly in verse 3 and 4. Where he says, But you are a shield around me, O Lord. You bestow glory on me and lift up my head. To the Lord I cry aloud, and he answers me from his holy hill. You are a shield around me. To the Lord I cry, verse 4, and he answers me from his holy hill. This is the prayer of David. Lord, you are a shield around me. Now, on what basis did he pray this prayer? He prayed this prayer because he knew God as a shield. Right? For a prayer to be effective, you need to know who God is. You need to know the character of God. You need to know the characteristics of God, the nature of God, who God is. And until you know who God is, you know, you will not be able to pray an effective prayer. And if you want to know who God is, that means you need to know your Bibles. If you're not reading your Bibles every day, if the Bible is not your companion every day means every day. Just like we eat food 3 times in a day, my dear friends, if you're not reading the Bible, your prayers cannot be effective. That's very, very clear. Very clear. All right? So, we should take this very seriously, that do we know our God? You know, and how effective are our prayers? What do our prayers really show forth? Our prayers are mainly for what? What are our prayers? What do our prayers look like? Shopping list. A shopping list, or it's just Lord, bless. You know, and I don't know whether the Lord gets tired of hearing the same thing over and over again. You know, the same names, the same. There's just nothing different in our prayers. Our prayers are the same every day. For years on end, we pray the same prayers. Not really concerned whether God is answering our prayers, not answering our prayers. That we don't even look at. We just say, Lord, keep on blessing. Because we don't know God. We don't know who God is. We don't know how God acts. We don't know whether God has acted or not. We don't even know that. We just say, Lord, keep on. So unless we know the Bible, my dear friends, this David knew his God. He knew God as a shield. And that is why he's saying, God, you are a shield around me. And then verse 4, he says, To the Lord I cry, and he answers me from it. He knows that this God will answer him. He knows this God will answer him. You know, so knowing God, you know, knowing about God and knowing God is a prerequisite to an effective prayer. Right, so please keep that in mind. Otherwise, the prayers are all many a times very, very ineffective. One very, very strange thing that I have not touched upon in this particular verse is, you bestow glory on me and lift up my head. In these worst circumstances that he is in, remember, he's running away. He's a king, all right? And he's got maybe a few hundred people with him, and he's running away from Jerusalem. And we know that, you know, even as he was running away, there was that other man, I forgot his name, and he was shouting curses at David at that time. You know, that those were the circumstances he was undergoing. He was virtually cursing David. He says, David, you are a murderer, and what is happening to you, it serves you right. You know, in those circumstances, he is going there. He is now saying, Lord, you bestow glory. Glory is a very positive word. You bestow glory on me and you lift up my head. What is he saying? There are at least five things that he's saying here when he talks of the kind of glory that God gives in trouble. God gives glory in trouble. The first, my dear friends, is that he's saying, Lord, you have not allowed me to be defeated. These are circumstances I'm in. The whole city of Jerusalem is against me. My army has gone against me. My son has gone against me. But I still have hope in you. My hope is in you. And that is my glory. Very important, my dear friends, that when we have faith in God, there are no circumstances in which we will not have hope. It will not be a hopeless situation. There will always be some hope. Why did Jesus Christ go to the cross? Or with what attitude did Jesus Christ go to the cross? Did he know that he was going to be resurrected again? Did he know that? Yes, it was with that hope. That hope that yes, I am going to the cross, but God is not going to, God my Father is not going to allow me to stay in the tomb for too long. So that is the first glory, my dear friends. As Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 8, he says, we are hard pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. Then he goes on to say, through all the problems that Paul is facing, he says, Lord, I know that you have not abandoned me. The first glory. Secondly, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 9, Paul talks about the thorn in the flesh. He says, Lord, I prayed to you. I prayed to the Lord three times. And all the three times God said, no. And what was the thorn in the flesh? We don't know. Whether it was some sickness. Some say that he was hunched back. And that was what he was praying for. Some say it was an eye problem that he had. That is what he was praying for. We do not know what it was. But it was some kind of sickness. Some kind of physical problem. And what is it that God told him? My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made known in your weakness. My strength is made known in your weakness. And that is why he goes on to say, if I ever boast of anything, I'll boast of my weaknesses, because in my weakness, God's strength is made known. That is the glory. When we go through the worst of circumstances and we rely upon the Lord, my dear friends, it is there that God shows his strength in us. You know, those worst of circumstances where we just could not have come out of it, you know, and we yet come out of it, we know that this is just by the grace of God. This is just by the strength of God. I often wonder at the Psalms 34. You know, Psalms 34 was written by David when he came out of the presence of the King of Gath. He had gone to the King of Gath, you know, as a refugee, and the King of Gath recognized him. He says, this is David, isn't it, of whom they're saying that he killed 10,000. You know, so David thinks that, you know, the king has recognized me, so he will kill me. So he behaves like a madman and he comes out of there. And then he writes this psalm. And I used to often think that why is he praising God for this? You know, he used his mind at that time. It came to his mind that, yes, I should behave like a madman and probably this man will leave me, and I did it and I came out. You see, what's God's role in this? And yet he knows that if God had not put that thought in his mind at that time, he would never have come out of. He knows that it is God who has done this. It is God who has shown his glory. It is God who has given me strength at that time. And that's why he praises the Lord. In our weakness, God's strength is made known. And that is why we can boast only of our weaknesses. That's what Paul says. Thirdly, Jesus Christ told us that because I am persecuted, they will persecute you also. Right? In John chapter 15 and verse 8, he talks about it. He says that if they treated me in this way, they will treat you also in that way. And so, why did they treat Jesus Christ in a particular way? Because he was walking on a path which was different from their particular path. He was going against their wishes. And when people persecute us, my dear friends, when they were persecuting David, it was only because he was walking in the path of God. So the fact that we are being persecuted, my dear friends, it shows that we are walking God's path and we are sharing in the sufferings of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the glory. You see, at that point we know that yes, this is happening to me because I'm walking God's path. That is the glory that has been bestowed upon us. That's the third thing. The fourth thing, my dear friends, as it says in Romans chapter 5 and verses 3 and 4, he says, we rejoice in our suffering. You can just read it, someone can read it. He says, we rejoice in our suffering because suffering produces perseverance. You know, Romans 5 and verse 3 and 4. Okay, right. It says that suffering produces perseverance and perseverance produces character. Okay, how does perseverance produce character? Perseverance in trials and sufferings and persecutions, it produces character, it says. How?
We depend on God, we wait upon the Lord, so there is patience in us.
Okay. It's at this time that our faith is refined. Right? It's at this time that our faith is refined. And as our faith is refined, our character is also refined. All right? It's God told the Israelites in Malachi chapter 3, he says that I'm going to refine your faith like gold in the furnace. Right, your faith is going to be refined through the furnace. So God refines our faith through these circumstances that we are undergoing. You know, and when he refines our faith, through our faith, our character, our hope, everything becomes stronger. So God uses, my dear friends, these circumstances of our life to refine us, to refine our faith. That's the fourth thing. And the last thing is given in James chapter 1 and verse 12. You know, when we persevere under trials, what does it show? Or what is it, what is there in store for us? Can somebody just read that? James 1 and verse 12.
Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them.
Okay, so there is something at the present, you know, that we saw in Romans chapter 5 and verse 3. It says when we persevere, that perseverance produces character and character produces hope. You know, but here it says there is also future glory. There's also future glory for those who persevere under trials. You know, and what is the future glory? It says we will receive the crown of life. The crown of life. What life are you talking about? Eternal life. The crown of eternal life. That God has promised for all those who love him. Alright? So, when David, my dear friends, you know, he makes this statement that God bestows his glory on me and lifts up my head. He is virtually saying that in spite of all that I'm undergoing, God has not left me. He is taking care of me, and I know that there is a purpose in what is happening in my life. You know, and that is what keeps man going in spite of the severe trials that he may undergo in his life. Now, what is the result of this confidence that he has on the Lord? Look at verse 4 and 5. What do you say there? The verse 5 and 6. It says, I lie down and sleep. Even when we don't have problems, we don't get sleep. Right? And here is a man who is undergoing so many problems in his life. And he says, I lie down and sleep. I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear the tens of thousands drawn up against me on every side. I lie down and sleep. Now, as one author says, this is not a sleep of arrogance. You know, there is a sleep of arrogance, saying that God is on my side, nothing will happen to me. Right? There's not that kind of sleep. The author goes on to say, it's a sleep of holy confidence. It's a sleep of holy confidence that God's grace and mercy, He grants me that I can have sleep in these circumstances. And when we have that kind of confidence in the Lord, Lord, I know I'm not worthy. I know these circumstances are too much for me, but please help me. Please help me and let me get some sleep. You know, when we have that kind of, an attitude and prayer, then my dear friends, God's peace, you know, it transcends over our circumstances. And in the worst of circumstances also, we are able to lie down and sleep. He knows, my dear friends, David knows very well that God is not only going to give me a good night rest, but He also will sustain me at that time. Why does He know that? He knows it, my dear friends, because in which condition is man most vulnerable? When he's sleeping. Most vulnerable. And think of David. David was most vulnerable because he was not in his palace. No fortification, no army. Just a few hundred people maybe with him. You know, and he's there in the wilderness. Most vulnerable. He lies down to sleep. You know, the army comes against him. He's gone. And yet we know here that he had his confidence on his God. Why? Because as Psalms 121, what does it say? My God neither slumbers nor sleeps. My God neither slumbers nor sleeps. And He is the one who sustains me. It is because of this confidence, my dear friends, that He is able to sleep in peace even in these circumstances. He knows that when sleep is like death. You know, we are not aware of anything. And anything can happen. You know, is at that time, he says, my God will take care of me. Even of tens of thousands, as it says here in verse 6, tens of thousands are drawn up against me on every side. Even in those circumstances, it's not a small kind of situation, it's a terrible situation. Tens of thousands are against me, but I know that I will be able to sleep well because God's peace is there upon me and God's sustaining power is there upon me. All right? The last few verses, verse 7 and 8, it comes as a surprise because what does it say? Arise, O Lord. Deliver me, oh my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw. Break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on all the people. Do you find this surprising? These two verses? You find it surprising? You know, after reading verse 3 and verse 4 and 5 and 6, probably we would think that God has brought him out of the situation. He has prayed, he has had confidence in God, he knows God, his prayer is effective, you know, everything is fine. So when you pray such a prayer, God will bring you out. But how does the psalm end? He says, Lord, arise. He's still asking the Lord to work. He has not come out of the situation. That is why I like this psalm, my dear friend, because it's a psalm of reality. It is not a psalm of popular teaching in the church, which, as I said, name it and claim it, which is basically based on hyper faith. Because that's not true. That's not true. You know, the Bible is not as simple as we think. We pray and things happen. It is not as simple as we think, my dear friends. There's a lot more to it. His struggle continues. His struggle, my dear friends, is continuing. And yet, he is showing a confidence in the Lord at this time. That's important. Living in those circumstances, he is showing a confidence in the Lord. You know, and probably verse 8, my dear friends, is probably the most important part of this psalm, where he is showing confidence in the Lord. What does he say? From the Lord comes deliverance. From the Lord comes deliverance. He is showing complete confidence. He says, Lord, I know that I am in this particular situation, but you are the one who will bring me out of it. He doesn't have confidence on his own self. Man like David, who is a great warrior. You know, he's a man who killed a lion and the bear with his bare hands. You see, how much confidence should he have upon his own self? And yet, confidence is not upon his own self. He says, Lord, you will deliver me. I know that you will take care of me. You know, and that confidence, my dear friends, is the most important thing. And the Bible, my dear friends, shows very, very clearly that whether it's temporal situations or eternal circumstance or eternal damnation, it is the Lord only who can take us out of that situation. And that is why it is absolutely important, my dear friends, that we learn to rely upon the Lord in all circumstances. The way the psalm ends, my dear friends, is even more, I would say, bewildering. Because what does he say? May your blessings be on your people. In these circumstances, what blessings does he think he has? And yet he knows that if the Lord does not bless, you know, nothing can happen. If the Lord's blessings are not there in one's life, nothing can happen. You see, Jesus Christ doing his ministry for 3.5 years and he's healing people, you know, tremendous things. You would say, yes, Lord's anointing was upon him. Lord's blessings was upon him. Was God's blessing upon him when he was going to the cross? See, people look at this part. You know, even today, you see, when ministers do great things, this is Lord's anointing, Lord's anointing. What about those people who are suffering? Persecuted. Today, tens of hundreds of people are there in jail in UP. And these are very small pastors, you know, people who conduct small house churches. They are conducting a meeting, some people come, taken to jail, no trial, nothing, they are there for months on end. Is God's blessings upon them? Or on people who do all kinds of miracles only? David says here, Lord, I know your blessings are upon me at this time. God's blessings, my dear friends, were upon Jesus Christ when he went to the cross, when he was there upon the cross. See, Jesus Christ knew that God's blessings was upon me. All the disciples, how did they die? All martyred, except for John. All martyred. And John was also there on the land of the island of Patmos. He was exiled. Right? Were they blessed? Even as they underwent persecution? Stephen, my dear friends, when he was being stoned, what does it say about him? His face shone. His face was shining as people were stoning him. Was God's blessings upon him? Yes. Even in those circumstances, my dear friends, we know that God's blessings were upon him. And David knows very clearly, my dear friends, that in this situation that he is in, he is only sustained because God's blessing. He knows, my son has gone against me, my people have gone against me, my army has gone against me, I have nothing except these few faithful people who are with me. But the one thing that has not left me in these circumstances is God's blessings. God's blessings. That is what sustains us. The world may go against us, my dear friends. We may be all alone. And yet we know that we can be sustained, because only when we know that God's blessings has not left me. As Paul tells in Romans chapter 8 and verse 32 onwards, it says, what can separate us from the love of God? What can take away the blessings of God from my life? And then he goes on to say, neither pestilence or famine or persecution or even death. When God has loved us, he will continue to love us for eternity. So friends, this is a powerful psalm of trust in the Lord in the midst of trouble. One of the common images of God, my dear friends, in the Bible is that of a refuge. And if a man needs a place to go in his problems, here is a place right in the presence of God. You know, knowing that he's our refuge and he's the one who will sustain us and provide every need of ours in those overwhelming circumstances. Let me end with a statement, my dear friends, that he may not change the circumstances. All right? But he will certainly change us through these circumstances. He may not change the circumstances, but he will certainly uphold us in those circumstances. So let our faith be strong in all circumstances, and may all of us experience his grace in a mighty way. Amen. Let's bow down in prayer. Father, thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, for once again reminding us that circumstances may not change, Lord, but you are there with us. You are changing us and you are making us more in the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us, God, we pray, to learn to trust you even as David trusted you. And that is what brought him back, Lord, to the palace master. Yes, Father, Lord, we commit ourselves in thy almighty arms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, we're going to sing one last hymn, hymn number 131. Hymn number 131, we'll rise to our feet and join in this beautiful hymn. It says, lead kindly light amid the circling gloom, lead thou me on. The night is dark and I am far from home, lead thou me on.
Light amid the circling gloom, lead thou me on. The night is dark and I am far from home, lead thou me on. Lead thou my feet, I do not ask to see the distant sea, one step enough for me. I was not here, but thus Lord prayed that thou shouldst lead me on. I love to choose and see my path, but now lead thou me on. I love the garish day in spite of years, pride ruled my will, remember not past years. So long thy path has blessed me, sure it still will lead me on. O'er moor and fen, o'er crag and torrent, till the night is gone. And with the morn, those angel faces smile, which I have loved long since and lost a while.
Well, in heaven, we thank and praise you, Master, for this time you give us. With this psalm, O Lord, Psalms 3, and thank you, Lord, for David, O Master, in spite of all his faults, O Master, Lord, and all that he did, which was against you, yet know, Master, why he was a man after your own heart. Because he loved you and he knew you, Master. And Father Lord, thank you for this psalm that he has written in the worst of circumstances, overwhelming circumstances. And Lord, we thank you for each word that is there. Thank you for speaking to us and keep on strengthening us, God, in the circumstances that we undergo. Give us your grace and mercy, O God, to just rely upon you so that the peace that he had, so that he could lie down and sleep in these circumstances, may be our peace, O Master, in all circumstances. Father, Lord, we commit ourselves in thy almighty arms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest upon each one of us, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen. Amen.